Som gör det.
So then it says the end, it is like the confluence of a stream with the ocean, like the meeting of mother and child. And so then when you continue to practice and you abide in the nature of mind, then in the at first in the middle, the thoughts will come down, and when that happens, then the thoughts arise, and then again they dissipate back into the mind on their own accord, just like a wave rises from the ocean and then dissolves back into the ocean. Also, once Bardhavoma, female disciple of Milarepa, was instructed by Milarepa on how to meditate, and Milarepa told her to meditate on her mind like an ocean. And later when she reported back, she said, but then when I meditate on my mind like an ocean, then right away the waves come and then they disturb me again. And so then Milarepa asked her, so then isn't the ocean the same as the wave, or is the ocean separate from the wave? So then what he is saying, that even if a thought arises, the thought is not separate from the mind. So this is another story in the 100,000 songs that you should also study. And so the thoughts that appear from the mind, arise in the mind, have the same essence as the mind. And therefore, if you just leave them be, don't bother with them, then they can't do anything. They will just dissolve again. Only if you cling to them, if you follow them, then those waves will become blocks of ice through the fixation, if they solidify. And so now in the end, when it is like the confluence of a stream, like the meaning of a mother and a child, and so that is then when there is no more such grasping, nothing moves the mind, and that is when you recognize the ground, which is like an ocean. And there's many different illustrations that are given, and these are all outer examples, and there's one example that I have personally come up with, because I found that it's quite fitting, because I find that the mind is quite like the light power, like electricity. And everything in this world runs with power, with electricity. Everything we do with power, all kinds of things. But then when you really look into that, in the end there's only one such thing as energetic power. And then, where is that? You can't actually see it. And you can use it, however. You can extract the power. For example, the power comes also from wind. When we extract from wind, the wind power, or we can take the power from water. It can be generated through many sources, naturally. That is the like electricity or power. And if you say there is power, then you can't actually find it. It's not really there. Where is it? You can't see it. But then you can't say it's not there, because it's very powerful and it is doing many things. So it is similar to that. The single ground, the nature of the mind, within which all beings are one, which is the ground of samsara and nirvana. So that we must decide on or resolve. And if you resolve that there is just a single ground, then only that confidence will place your mind into a very easeful state. Because if you just understand my nature, within my nature, everything is contained. Samsara and nirvana is my nature. Then you have not much work to do anymore. Nothing is separate from you. And so also, moreover, this is where the benefit of beings comes from the understanding that there is just a single ground. Because, for example, when we say, may beings have happiness and the causes of happiness. So then you see the nature of the mind and you cultivate love. And that beneficial mind, that is pervasive. And then you think, may beings be free from suffering and the causes of suffering. And so then also you understand that suffering is just another mental arising. And since our minds are a single ground, my own thoughts and the thoughts of all beings are the same nature. So these are also things you can impart on others. For example, if you want to explain to somebody how to meditate, you tell them to meditate. And then when suffering and difficulty arises, then you meditate on that arising at the same time with the understanding that there's only one such thing called suffering. And therefore, you know that if suffering is just a thought, it can disappear. And so in this way, one practitioner can help another practitioner. And why can we help each other in this way? It is, according to the Buddhist view, due to three powers. The first one is called the power of your own intent, your own kindness. It is necessary first for you to cultivate faith, kindness and compassion. And then secondly, the second power is the power of the Tathagatas. That is the great compassion, the unconditioned natural compassion of all the Buddhas. And then the third power is the power of Dharmadhatu. And that is that single ground or the single mind continuum. And all the Buddhas and all the sentient beings have that mind. And even though many waves may appear on the ocean, they actually do not exist as separate entities. And understanding that, you understand that, therefore, this basis of samsara and nirvana lacks any inherent substantial existence. And so therefore, even though temporarily, you know, due to certain conditions that we encounter, we grasp temporarily, the mind of the beings is like a block of ice. But then, actually, there are no sentient beings in reality. And so it is said that in a prayer, in reality, no object of compassion exists. And so a wise person understands that ice is actually water. A foolish person thinks that ice is a stone, a rock, because it's hard like a rock. So clearly it's a rock because when I hit you over the head, you bleed. Because it performs the function of a rock, it's for them a rock. But really, it is not inherently a rock. It is water. And it shows that whatever we grasp at, this is what it becomes in the mind to us. And so when here it says, at the end, it is like a confluence of a stream coming together, that is just like all the different waters in the world. In the end, they flow together into the vast ocean. They come from one source, and in the end, they dissolve back into this one source.